Yeah. Yeah. Draft day, Johnny Manziel. 5 years later, how am I the man still? Draft day, A. Wiggins. That other side, we stay winning. Oh man, you know I had to do it for you. You know I had to do it for you. Yeah. Suits and ties yelling out, pay the guys, man, I had to do it for you. You know I had to do it for you. You know I had to do it for you. Oh man, oh man, oh man, man, you know I had.
Welcome back to the Racial Draft Podcast. I am your host, Michael Ford. And this week, I have a very special guest, Taye. Introduce yourself to the people.
Hello, everyone. I am Taye, a.k.a. Taylani Stark. I've known you, Mike, for how long now?
Maybe about a year.
Just about a year, yeah. Right. I'm so excited because this is actually the first time I've been on this podcast. And thank you for inviting me on.
Yeah, you know, let the people know where they can find you. We can do that at the end as well. But, you know, right. Some of the other projects that you've got going on.
Well, I am a YouTuber and I'm also a TikToker. You can find me at Taylani Stark on all platforms, YouTube, okay. TikTok, Instagram, and that big blue bird app that we are struggling to leave.
Yeah, for sure.
The toxic relationship we have with Twitter.
It continues. So let the listeners know a little bit more about you in terms of like your relationship to geek / nerd culture, however you want to define it. What are your top five like nerd, properties, we'll say?
Oh, goodness. Well, see, I was an off and on fan for, I want to say since like maybe the first Spider-Man movie, because okay. I'm very close to my older brother. He's 10 years older than me. We went to see the very first X-Men film together. We went to see Spider-Man and I left the theater like, does Mary Jane figure out that he's Spider-Man? I knew nothing. And he was like, no, they get married. I was like, oh, okay. But it really wasn't until, I don't think I've ever told you this. It really wasn't until I started cosplaying. Mm-hmm. And I haven't cosplayed since maybe 2017. Okay. But it wasn't until then that I actually started getting more into the source material because I wanted to learn more about these characters, you know, outside of like, obviously Storm from the X-Men.
Right.
The mainstream ones that within geek and nerd circles, people just talk about, like, you, even if you've never picked up a comic, like, you know who Storm is, you right. know who Iron Man is, you know who Spider-Man is. So very casual. I wouldn't call myself a geek until I was on Facebook and I used to follow this Deadpool page. I don't know what happened to it, but somebody drew a picture of Deadpool dressed as Tony Stark. And I started feelings because I playfully called Deadpool my comic book boyfriend. He is my absolute favorite comic book character. Yes, he's out of his mind, but that's part of the appeal.
Sure.
And when I saw that picture, I was like, you know what? It's time. It's time for me to just admit who I am. I can't hide it anymore. So that's when I turned to my best friend, who's not here right now, but I was like, yeah, slap that geek label on me. We're going to go through all the things. We're going to all the movies. I'm actually the first comic I ever bought was Wonder Woman's Rebirth comic, like after they rebooted after the New 52. Sure. And like I actually went to, because I used to live in New York. Mm-hmm. So I actually went down to Midtown Comics, bought it and devoured it and like on the train ride home. So
yeah.
And then actually started getting into geek discussions with groups of people that I found through the fandom. Mm-hmm. We would all get up, go to movies together, and I would have conversations about what we just watched, whether we liked it or not. I remember we had big fights after Batman v Superman.
Team Martha and Team Not Martha.
Oh my God. Why'd you say that name? I'm like, and what's sad is I have a friend named Martha. So when movie came out, she was just like, I hate it. I hate it. I don't ever want to have anything to do. If I see Henry Cavill or Ben Affleck, I'm punching them in the nose because how dare they? I'm like, they just said the lines that they were given.
No, on the other hand, you could be like, you know, I'm the reason. I'm the reason that you didn't kill one another. Thank you very much.
Exactly. Embrace it. But yeah, it's been a love of mine, I want to say, since, oh goodness, yeah, since about 2015.
Okay.
So that was when, like, I think the very first Marvel movie I saw in theater, specifically like MCU movie that I saw in theater, was the first Ant-Man.
Oh, okay. And so you, like, went back and watched the other ones before that? Yeah. I mean, you know, the ones that came out before that?
Oh, yeah. Actually, no, that's a lie. The first one I saw was Iron Man. My brother's favorite actor is Robert Downey Jr. Okay. His favorite comic book character is Iron Man. So when he heard Iron Man was coming out, he's like, get in the car. I want you to read these comics. I'm going to tell you about, like, we would drive everywhere and he would tell me the story, stories about Iron Man and, like, just and break it down for me before we saw the movie. And then he was real hyped after that very first end credit scene where he's like,
Avengers Initiative. Yes.
Avengers are coming. I was like, I want to be as hyped as you are about this. But
I remember that. I remember it wasn't like it is now with all the different scoop sites. But I remember reading somewhere that Marvel was planning to do solo movies and then eventually do an Avengers movie. So I was kind of been prepped for that. But then that moment where Samuel L. Jackson walks out as Nick Fury and he's like, you think you're the only superhero out there. I'm like, oh, they're doing You know, and I feel like it's hard to put into words the experience of being like a longtime comic fan and then seeing the promise of those characters in live action, just a little, even the tease of it. You know, I feel like sometimes the fans that are somewhat younger that have never not had these properties in their lives kind of take it for granted a little bit.
Yeah.
You know, but, you know, when you were in that mold of like, they'll never bring these characters to live action. They're going to stick with the main ones. They're going to stick with Spider-Man, Superman, Batman, maybe Wonder Woman. We'll see. You know what I mean? Like that was just kind of what you had to deal with. And then occasionally they might have, you know, some kind of animated thing, which would, you know, somewhat satisfy you. Or there'd be some show that lasted for 1.5 seasons with really bad special effects. And you know,
right?
And you would just be like, "This is what we've got to deal with."
Exactly.
You know, this is what it means. So, you know, my origin story does stretch a little bit further back, as far as, you know, being a child and getting, you know, comics from my older relatives and never having enough money to actually like read through the whole storyline. You know, I'd have to read like one issue and just imagine what else happened. And then when I got a little older, I would go to the library and the older kids who collected comics would let me read their comics after they were done, you know, so I still couldn't afford to collect them. But if I showed up every week, you know, or every couple weeks, I could figure out, Peter Parker's getting married to Mary Jane. What? You know, and Venom, you know, like, and, you know, it wasn't until I got, you know, I got into high school, I had a little money in my pocket, then I could start to go to the comics shop every week, spend my $10 to $15, you know, and, you know, hang out with my other geek friends and talk about and exchange our comics. But then once I got to, you know, I would say sophomore year of college, from sophomore year of college till like 2004, I basically like was out on comics because I just couldn't stay current. And at that point, digital comics weren't a thing. And I just sort of let it go for a while. And every time I would sort of see something in the news about comics, I would be like, oh man, that was kind of fun. I kind of wish I got back into it. And it was digital comics that gave me the opportunity to catch up on all the old storylines and, you know, kind of bridge the gap from my childhood to my adulthood. And then now look at me, I'm all immersed in it, you know? And look, I mean, listeners, this just goes to show that, you know, we at the Racial Draft Podcast, we're really accepting of, you know, nerds and geeks of all stripes, no matter how recently or how long you've been in the game. As long as you've got the passion, as long as we've got characters and properties that you're into, we love to hear your voices. We love to hear, you know, what brought you to the community and what keeps you in the community. But you didn't quite answer my question in the sense that what are your big, you know, pop culture, genre properties that you're most heavily invested in?
Right now, goodness, I know the first season is out and I love it. I don't know if I've talked to you about this before, but Moon Girl and Devil Dinosaur. I have the comics. I have the collections. And when I heard they were doing a cartoon, I was like, I absolutely have to watch it. I absolutely loved it. Yes, there are changes, just like there are changes in the MCU, but they work for the universe that they're trying to build within the show. And also, I mean, she reps New York in a way that... She reps the Lower East Side, and I spent a good amount of time in the Lower East Side when I lived in New York. I'm also a huge, huge Lord of the Rings fan.
Okay.
I watch every single episode of Rings of Power. Absolutely love it. My mom, when I was younger, she made me watch the very first Hobbit cartoon, the animated movie. And then... Again, my older brother, we went to see all three Lord of the Rings movies. So that's something that I hold near and dear to me. Obviously, because of my history with that, the X-Men will always be in there. I'm more Marvel than DC, but DC has certain like one-off comics from DC. Like there's a comic that my best friend let me read because it was right before the first time Bruce Wayne and Selina Kyle were supposed to get married. And he and Superman double dated.
Oh yeah. I remember that. The Tom King run.
They went to a carnival and you have Selina like, what am I doing? And it was just, I want more of the relationship between Lois Lane and Selina Kyle. But I will always hold the X-Men. It's probably controversial. I will always hold the X-Men above the Avengers.
I mean, it's not very controversial. I mean, really, what it really comes down to, I mean, X-Men's been a part of a lot of people's childhoods, you know, if they got into comics when they were teenagers or preteens. But it was just that the movies weren't very good, you know, because in my opinion, the movies never actually did justice to the characters beyond just, you know, one or two characters, and you really felt it when it came to the people of color, of which, you know, disproportionately there should be more mutants that are people of color, but whatever, we'll get into that. We always occasionally get into that on this podcast, so we don't have to go all the way into the weeds of it, but the point is the comics X-Men are so much, they speak to particularly young people, particularly teenagers, you know, because these characters get their powers when they're teenagers. You know, it's very much, in addition to being an allegory for marginalized people, it's also an allegory for adolescence, you know, for, you know, your powers come into play, your body is changing, you know, and you have to come to grips with what those changes mean. And, you know, sometimes it makes you feel like a freak or an outcast, and, you know, and then you find other people who feel just as much as a freak or an outcast, and you find community, and then some people get angry and they decide they're going to lash out at society. You know what I mean? All these things that allow for these stories to be nuanced and connect to us as readers. And then in contrast, you have the Avengers, which is more like kind of, I would say that the X-Men is more like a teen drama, like a 90210. And the Avengers are more like your 9 o'clock PM drama, like your ER. You know what I mean?
That's the best way I've ever heard it put.
Right. So it's like, it's also a drama. It's also a soap opera, but it's much more about like a workplace, you know, about people who work together and develop relationships around their coworkers, as opposed to people who grow up together and are in school together, and they have those kinds of relationships, and they grow up out of those relationships. So I just, right. so I think that, like, and then of course, there's so many mutants, and you know, there's only but so many people who can be on the Avengers at a given right. time before there's, you know, it's bloated.
You're right. So,
but I think that Marvel has done a really good job in the last 10 to 15 years of making the Avengers matter. Not quite, you know, to where it's even a debate is what I'll say, to where it's even right. a debate of X-Men versus Avengers, because growing up, people really didn't care about, I mean, they cared, but they cared about the Avengers when there was an event happening. They didn't right. really care about the Avengers other than that. The way in fact, this is going to be controversial. I kind of feel that way about the Fantastic Four. Like, I think that people like the individual Fantastic Four members. They all have their favorites that right. they like, but they also like seeing them in other people's stories, you know?
Right.
They like seeing the Thing, you know, having his little poker game or fighting with the Hulk. You know, they like Johnny Storm hanging out with Spider-Man. They like Reed Richards, you know, solving some problem in a crossover event. And they like Sue Storm just because they like Sue Storm. but in terms of, you know, even people who like the Fantastic Four, you know, who say they like the Fantastic Four, there's only maybe a handful of stories that they keep coming back to and revisiting.
Right.
And I would say that, you know, in my mind, the Hickman run that really sort of started in Fantastic Four and went through Avengers into Secret Wars is, you know, that's the sort of seminal Fantastic Four run. But even that kind of is, you know, intertwined with the rest of the universe. It's not just a self-contained Fantastic Four story. I think the Fantastic Four tend to be more so than the other characters tied in to everyone else in order right. for it to really work. They're kind of connective tissue characters. And that's why I'm really interested in what it's going to be like when they introduce the Fantastic Four in the MCU. Because this is a universe that has been formed around them not being there.
Right.
How are they going to be made to be as integral and as central as they typically are in the comics?
Yeah. I'm just, whew, I wish they would just hurry up and announce the cast, because I am so weary of these fan castings and the rumors and the arguments back and forth. I'm like,
Fantastic Four fan cast might be the worst fan cast. they really might be. Because the thing is, I think the hardest part is that there are four of them and their chemistry matters.
Right.
So, you know, it's sometimes you can cast one character, you know, whether you're casting based on the look or you're casting based on the vibe or you're casting based on who's hot, like you can have an idea of who you think this one character is and which actor you think embodies that character. But with the Fantastic Four, you have to do it not only four times, but then you have to pick actors that you think could vibe off of each other. And that doesn't always work.
Right.
You know, you might say, oh, this person will make the best read, but then this person that you pick for Sue, you're like, could you really see them together? You know, and then, or you pick like someone for Johnny and then someone for Sue, but then they don't seem like they're siblings, you right. know? So it throws people off, and then they end up just kind of getting really bland. They just go right for the most milquetoast thing because they're like, whatever, you know,
just throw them in there.
I feel nothing. I feel nothing. But I feel four nothings, you know, and
then you get a movie where it's just like, well, that exists.
Right. You know, so I definitely trust Marvel's casting people more than I trust Twitter's casting people. So.
Absolutely.
but like you, I'm kind of waiting for these cast members to be announced just so that we can finally stop playing the four fan cast game.
it's like they have them like on a wheel, and it's like, who are we gonna start a rumor about today? Oh, right. Jessica Alba might make an appearance. No, let her stay over there with her Honest brand. I don't think she wants to put on the wig again. I think we're good.
Yeah, but I mean, I do hope that they don't. I do hope that they announce them all at once and don't slow play it, because, you know, because just announcing one just hits the afterburner on all the other rumors.
Right.
Everyone, all these sites want to get their rumors in under the wire.
And that's probably something else we can discuss. It's just like the people that post whatever about these movies for clicks. Like, it's, you're right. As soon as Sue gets cast, if Sue gets cast first, I mean, it's going to happen with all of them. As soon as one person gets cast, it's going to be like, all right, who do I think has the best chemistry with this one? Who do I want to see and scream with them? And then we get article after article about rumor. And
look, I get it.
It just muddies the waters.
I write for some of these sites every now and then, right? So I get why, like, if you're the editor, like, one of the easiest stories to get, one of the easiest pitches to get greenlit is, all right, now that this person's been cast, name five actresses, you know, if it's for Reed, you know, name five actresses who you'd like to see as Sue. And then, you know, after Sue is cast, name five actors you'd like to see as, you know, as Johnny. If, again, it's just boom, 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 get these, pound these articles out, get these clicks, clicks. You know what I mean? Like, so I get it. I mean, people love people. I'm looking at, it's so funny. It's like, sometimes you'll just see four actors and you'll immediately get triggered. You're like, is this a Fantastic Four? Fantastic Four pick. It's like three guys and one woman. It's like, oh, you're the Fantastic Four. So yeah, we talked about the Reed rumor last week of it being Adam Driver. And you know, he wouldn't be my first choice, but if he is cast, I wouldn't have an issue, because I think he's a really good actor. You know?
Yeah, I saw that man on Broadway. Like,
okay.
He can act the house down, but I'm just like, I'm like, just say yes or no. I'm tired.
Yeah.
We are tired.
But you know, Kevin Feige's like, every day they speculate on Reed Richards is a day that they're not asking me about Jonathan Majors. Right? He pressing that rumor button. All of when's his court date?
Exactly. Push everything other than.
That's what they're gonna do. They're gonna wait until his court date, like, and the day of his court date, that's when they'll drop the Fantastic Four.
Exactly. Hit the button.
So Leah, on that note, let's dive into some of our stories. You know, okay. We'll come back around and talk about racial draft business in a second. But you know, first off, let's talk about these. We got the CinemaCon, right? So we got some trailers. We got some trailers over the weekend, over the past week rather. Were there any highlights for you as far as the trailers?
Oh goodness. Well, I mean, the funny thing is, most of the stuff that I'm looking forward to, like. Most of the trailers already dropped. So like when I, like most of the stuff from CinemaCon, I was like, oh, okay. But like, off the top of my head, I can't think of anything that was like specifically from CinemaCon. I know we got it, like finally got like the extended trailer for, I don't know if we got that from CinemaCon, but I know we finally got an extended trailer for like Transformers Rise of the Beast.
Yeah, that came out of CinemaCon. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah, that's probably one of the things that I'm most hyped for. Like, yeah. I've rarely been the type of person where it's like opening day, I gotta be there. It's usually opening weekend. Like I went to see the Super Mario Brothers movie opening weekend because I had to, but I was like, Transformers Rise of the Beast, especially with that soft reboot of Bumblebee gave me hope. So I'm like,
sure did.
I was like, I might have to see that day of, if it's a Wednesday, but if it actually drops on a Friday, well, no, because it's going to be summer, so a lot of them are doing Wednesday releases now.
I think it depends on when the I think it depends on whether it's like a holiday or something like that. So like you know, like 4th of July, they'll do it like that Tuesday if they can get away with it.
Right.
but yeah, I think it's because it's the end of June. I want to say June. Is it the end of June or the beginning of June? Now I'm forgetting. Let me look it up. Sorry, guys. I know this is bad. I know this is bad audio. You can vamp if you want.
So I'll talk about another piece of fandom. I'm also a bit of a gamer.
Okay.
So my favorite video game is of all time is Mortal Kombat.
Okay. Oh, June 9th is just to answer your question. Okay.
Okay, you're right, because I for some reason I was thinking like you. I was thinking it was end of July. It made more sense. It would make more sense to me to release it like 4th of July weekend. But
well, you've seen that calendar. There's a lot. There's a lot dropping. You know, you got to contend with Barbie. You got to contend with Oppenheimer. You've got to deal with the Flash problem.
Flash. Oh Lord, that's a touchy one, yeah. Right there.
I'm just gonna call it the Flash problem. For
that's basically, and that's forward. What it is at this point. That is basically what it is. It's I'm so conflicted about whether or not I want to see it, because my Batman has always been Michael Keaton.
Okay.
Like, I watched that movie like it, let's say, like it was a TV show. But like when I was in second grade and it was on VHS, I watched it almost every day after school. So I'm like, I want to see Michael Keaton in the bat suit again. But then there's Ezra. And do, I mean, we
look, Ezra,
do we want to give them?
Look, Ezra's been a problem, like, but it's so weird. It's weird for me because I've known about Ezra as an actor for a while now. And I was not impressed at any point with their performance as Barry Allen in any of these movies.
Oh, same.
And this was even before all of the other off-camera incidents. However, I did feel like Ezra was a talented actor. So it was kind of like, what a waste of talent, you know?
Right.
And then all of a sudden, all this crime started happening, and crimes and rumors of crime. And it was kind of, and you know, I don't like to be reactionary. So I don't like to say like, well, I'm not a fan, so fire them. You know what I mean?
Right. You know,
it seems disingenuous, right? It's like, if it was something that I was a fan of, you know, at least I'd be like, oh man, that sucks. You know, I guess we'll have to see what the courts decide.
Exactly.
See what the courts decide, you know. And of course, there does reach, for any artist, there does reach a level where you can't see them without thinking of.
Right.
You know, but generally speaking, you know, actors can disappear into their role. And, you know, if there's enough else going on in a movie or something, if it's not relying on their likability or relying on their charm, you know, you can usually suck it up for an hour and a half and be like, that person's a piece of shit, but really good in the role.
Exactly.
You know, so that's generally been my perspective, that if the movie's good, I don't actually have to praise. I mean, I don't have to praise Ezra the person. I can say Ezra the person is a problem, thus the Flash problem. Ezra the person is a problem, but the studio made a good movie. And for DC, it's not like they've got a bunch of great movies, you know, on their list. You know, like, I understand why, from their perspective, they've sunk over $1 billion into making these movies. And people are just dying for a reboot.
Right.
like, please, no more. No more.
We just want one good one. Yes, we have it.
And when you have these executives who have staked their entire reputation and their careers on, you know, putting out these movies, like, we're not naive about the things that people do to cover up to make loads and loads of money.
Right.
You know, so it's just like, all right. I mean, I don't have to praise the individual. I don't have to say that this, you know, it more power to them in terms of getting help, in terms of, you know, dealing with whatever demons that they're dealing with.
Mm-hmm.
It's been about a year since any new offenses popped up. You know, maybe in a couple more years we'll be convinced that this person, you know, has really cleaned up their act.
Right.
But you know, and I would not begrudge anyone for saying no way. You know, don't want to see the person on the screen. But I also know that Ezra's not exactly a household name.
Right.
So a lot of the things that we're talking about on a show like this, because this is what we cover, my parents, you know, my aunts and uncles or whatever, people who kind of know what the Flash is and know superheroes, you know, if it looks good, they're going to see it.
Right.
you know, and then maybe they'll hit the Google and be like, who's this Ezra Miller character?
Right.
Then be shocked and horrified. So, I mean, but all that is to say that I thought the trailer looked good, but that doesn't really say much because a lot of their movies have had good trailers and have not actually been good. The thing that gives me the most faith is that every single time something happened with Ezra, they would go to like someone from the studio and they'd be like, movie's too good. We're still putting it out.
Yep.
Movie's too good to cancel.
Mm-mm. Exactly. So it's like, no, y'all getting this movie.
Yeah. It's like, yeah, it's like, I mean, maybe we'll have to kill Ezra. So they'll get the bump, the posthumous bump.
Exactly.
Solves everybody's problems. You know? Oh, mysterious death of Ezra Miller.
Put that in memory of
exactly in memoriam. Yeah, maybe that's, you know what, we just solved the problem.
Okay, there you go.
Fake Ezra Miller death. Like that could be a plot line in one of those shows, those Hollywood fixer shows, you know.
I pray for publicists every day.
Yeah, for sure.
Because they are going through it this summer.
It's like, oh man, Ezra's plane disappeared in the Bermuda Triangle. Like, oh darn.
Just like that Malaysia flight.
Oh darn. Yeah.
Netflix documentary.
Whatever happened to Ezra Miller?
Somebody's writing it right now.
But yeah, going back to the Transformers, Rise of the Beast, another one of the highlights. Was the Barbie trailer came before CinemaCon, right?
Yes.
We didn't get, okay. I feel like there was one more trailer that came out of CinemaCon, but it's not, I'm not remembering it. Oh, well. But so yeah, we had CinemaCon. There were a lot of things that weren't publicly released that they showed at CinemaCon, so we'll just have to wait for some of that to leak. We also got the news about our gal Rihanna as Smurfette.
Okay.
Oh, you thought it was gonna be bad news?
Because like when I heard about that, I was like, okay, what are we doing here? Because like they, because a lot of like the articles that I read after that came out was like, she's recording new music for the movie.
Oh yeah, she's doing that.
Oh yeah, because I know how hungry the Navy is for new music from Rihanna. But I was just like, Rihanna's only done one voiceover before, and that was like, I think that movie was Home. So I'm like, okay. It was more of like, is this going back to we're casting a big name to get butts in the seats?
Yes, 100%. But okay. I also wonder if, you know, like you said, the Navy is hungry or thirsty, whatever hierarchy of needs for Rihanna music. Like, could she say to herself, I mean, A, it's a starring role in a movie.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to remix all my old music into Smurf music.
Right.
And then give them like three new songs, and it was a whole new album of Smurf soundtrack featuring Rihanna as Smurfette, and Smurfette is supposed to be the main character of this,
right? Because so I haven't heard about anybody else.
Yeah, so it's basically a vehicle, you know, for her.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't realize that she had that strong of a relationship with Paramount that they would kind of give her the keys that way. But you know, she's a huge star.
Well, yeah, like she's, you know, but she's got Savage X Fenty, she's got Fenty.
Will they do a Fenty Blue fashion show of Smurf Blue? Just can they pull that off?
If she doesn't, it's a missed opportunity.
Okay.
It's absolutely missed opportunity. They might, because like she did with Fenty Beauty, she did a whole separate collection for her halftime show. So I cannot see her being like, well, let's put some more coin in these coffers. You know, she's got baby number two on the way.
That's right. And she can record, you know, she doesn't have to stand up. She can, you know, get real comfortable in the chair and get her Smurf voice going. you know, so.
Yeah, I'm just, it's so weird because it's like, this is like the third attempt because they had the first two Smurf movies. And I know mm-hmm. those were live action and this one's going to be animated. But
weren't they like CG in the real world style movies? Okay.
Yeah. So yeah. Neil Patrick Harris was involved. So I'm just like, okay, what different angle are we going to take to make this fresh? I mean, besides getting Rihanna in there. But I'm waiting for my Snorks movie. I was always
You see, they can't do Snorks before they get Smurfs right. You know, because they're just underwater. Listen, they're underwater Smurfs.
Listen, I was always more of a Snorks girl than the Smurfs, okay? I listened to the theme song still gets spins in this house.
Okay. So you win on the theme song, the theme, you know.
But I'm like, if all the IP, I mean, I'm surprised they haven't brought, because they already did Yogi. I'm surprised more Hanna-Barbera IP isn't getting pushed to the forefront. Because you got my niece and nephews don't know who the Smurfs are.
They don't?
Not really.
I thought the Smurfs were iconic.
I mean, for you and I, I'm like, my nephew is 18 and my niece is 14. And I'm like, y'all know about Smurfs? They're like, what is this, auntie? They're just like, I haven't to describe, like, I had to tell her who Vanity Smurf was. Because like, why does one of these Smurfs have a mirror? And I'm like, okay. Mm-hmm. So I don't know. It's just, there's certain things that aren't transcending generations like that. So that's maybe that's why, again, I think you tweeted it a couple days ago where you were like, if ever you ask who asked for this, it's always the stockholders.
Yes, that's the answer, guys. That's always the answer. They're like, we own the rights of the Smurf. What are we doing here? What are we doing? Are we gonna make money or not? Like,
right. And I think that probably ended me ever asking that question again, because I used to be one of those people who it's like, oh, we're gonna like the Harry Potter show that's gonna be on HBO Max. Yeah. It's like, who asked for, no, stockholders. Okay.
Yeah. It's like, have you seen that stock price? That WBD stock price is like, guys, I know she hates trans people. I know. We'll, again, she'll be on the same flight with Ezra Miller. It'll be fine. we're going to have Ezra Miller, JK Rowling. Who else? Who else is getting on this flight?
It's like, no, all expense paid. Just go.
Yeah, it's fine. Yeah. And then it's like, got him. You know, now we can do Harry Potter. But
it's like,
yeah, like I so, you know, but back to the Smurfs, I have never seen any of those CG live action Smurf movies. It doesn't mm-hmm. I didn't think I was gonna like the Mario movie, honestly. Like, I love that growing up as a kid. It had to win me over, you know. I had to sort of see a couple trailers, kind of, you know, start off kind of rolling my eyes a little bit, and, you know, see another one and be like, you know what, this could be cute, you know, and then just kind of little by little kind of fall into the, all right, I'm gonna give it a try. It seems like it's a good time.
Like, right.
I think that you could do the same, especially people our age, you know, who have a little bit of nostalgia for it. If you, it's Paramount, so I don't know how their animated movies kind of do compared mm-hmm. to Disney or Illumination or whatever. But, you know, if they can put together some solid trailers and they've got some good music and they have some other voice actors that are funny, you know, we'll see how it goes. But I'm rooting for Rihanna, of course.
Always rooting for Rihanna.
You know, I'm trying to think, like, I've always thought that there's just an endless new Smurfs that you could introduce. I remember they used to do that on a cartoon. They would discover new Smurfs and seasons. You know, that's how we got like Baby Smurf or I can't remember the other ones, but
right. I was like, I know there were three kids, but I can't remember their names for the lives of me.
Right, exactly. But you know, listen, adjective Smurf, like,
right.
Like, just think about the memes, right? You know how they did the Barbie memes? Just imagine being able to Smurf yourself. Like,
oh, true. Okay, so, see, I didn't even think about that. I didn't even think about, like, oh, how would they market that? There you go. Yeah. Because that was all over Twitter for a good 3 weeks.
Yeah. Get like a Snapchat Smurf filter. Like, there's,
oh, goodness.
Listen, if you're a Paramount shareholder, you're going through all the different licensing opportunities for the Smurfs, and you're hoping that, you know, that Rihanna smurfs us all the way to the all the way to the bank.
It's like she's a billionaire. Let's bring in that billion-dollar business.
Exactly. What else is going on as far as in the IP world? We got some more. I'll stay in the world realm of animated, kind of bringing together two of the stories. We got the official announcement of the Transformers animated movie.
Yes.
Not the first, according, you know, what they said, because I remember when Optimus Prime broke my heart.
Okay, see, I can never watch that movie again. Because it's Niagara Falls.
Oh, well, look, I mean, all I have to hear is, you got the touch. You got the power.
And it's even worse because I met Peter Cullen.
Oh, okay.
Like, I won, through Twitter, I won tickets to the premiere of the fourth Transformers movie, the one where they brought in Mark Wahlberg and all of that.
It's a Transformer.
the Boston accent be thick. But yeah, and like he walked past me and my best friend, and he was telling the interviewer, he's like, we started chanting his name. He's like, I don't know what all of this is. Like, people don't know really who I am. It's like, I just do this voice. And we were like, no, you are a part of our childhood.
Yeah.
Like, we love you. And he just started weeping. And I'm like, I'm gonna cherish this forever. I'm like, you could tell he was genuinely moved because he was like, I don't know what any of this is.
Well, this version will not be having Peter Cullen.
Right.
I know that there was some consternation, but it's, you know, but this is a Transformers. It's called Transformers 1, O-N-E. And it's going to be about the breakup with frenemies, you know, best friends to enemies of young Optimus Prime and young Megatron, played by Chris Hemsworth, and Brian Tyree Henry. And we're also going to have John Hamm playing Sentinel Prime, Lawrence Fishburne as Alpha Trion, Keegan-Michael Key as Bumblebee, and Scarlett Johansson as Alita. I think it's Alita 1, but how much you want to guess there's going to be some kind of love triangle with ScarJo, you know?
Because she just can't be in a piece where she's not the object of somebody's affection. And no hate, I love her. I'm actually very excited for this voice cast.
Oh yeah, for sure.
And I think I said it on Twitter before, like, any media with Transformers where it's been animated eats.
Yeah.
Like, I have not watched a Transformers iteration that was animated that I have not loved. Like, there's I think Paramount Plus has a cartoon, Transformers Earthspark, and they have like a whole new race of Transformers that are born on Earth, and my best friend and I watched it, and it's amazing. Actually, okay. If I return to YouTube, I could probably
do a review series,
do a series. I probably should.
Yeah, do watch alongs.
You know, we'll talk after this because I've been trying to figure out how to do that. Like, for my return to YouTube, I haven't touched my YouTube channel in like a year and a half, but I was like, that's what I was going to start doing, is coming back and doing like reactions.
Yeah. All right. Yeah. We can talk about it, but okay. Yeah, I mean, I'm hyped. This movie's coming out July 19th, 2024. So next year. So I guess they've been working on it.
Yeah, I like the storyline because I know there are a lot of people who are like, well, how did the war in Cybertron begin? I know that it's been touched on in previous, like I think the very first Transformers movie, they touched on it briefly, but to actually go deep into explore the relationship between Optimus and Megatron, especially once you, like me, if you've watched Transformers Earthspark, where they're once again working together.
Oh, okay.
So,
yeah, I mean, in the comics, like, there's a really well-regarded run, I want to say IDW Transformers, that's just excellent. So there's a lot of lore to draw from if they decide to go that route. And I'm rooting for, I mean, Transformers was such a big part of my childhood, and I was just getting subsequently disappointed, you know, each time another Michael Bay Transformers movie would come out, you know, I would just be like, oh man, they got me. Now, you want to talk about a toxic relationship. It's me showing up on day one for every Transformers movie only to be disappointed up until we got Bumblebee.
Yep. I loved the first one, and then just everything after that to me was booty cheeks. I don't I'm like, how do you keep messing up?
Well, the worst
Michael
part
Bay
about
had,
it,
he had an excuse with the second one, because the second one was, they had to film it within the midst of the first Hollywood writers' strike, so
like
he had
writers.
That's the excuse he used.
Okay, fair enough.
But it still doesn't. Anyway.
Yeah, it doesn't excuse the racist Transformers. Sorry, I'm never giving him.
If I ever see him in just, because you know I live in LA now, if I ever see him in just regular public, like, how dare you?
Yeah, exactly. But we're past that now. We're beyond the Bayhem, and we're in a new era. And I'm hoping that between Rise of the Beast and this and Transformers 1, this franchise will be ready to go. I mean, I've told them, I'll tell you guys on whatever medium you want to hear it, that what you need to do is you need to get the whole cast of those Fast movies and have them voice and have them voice Transformers. Have them do the Stunticons, you know, and it's right there.
Not the Stunticons.
Yeah. So imagine voice of Tyrese and the voice of Ludacris bickering back and forth. It's money. It's money, I tell you.
Gold mine. Instant classic.
You know, just find out, you know, it's like, we're not just a team. We're a family.
We're family.
You know, it's right there. It's right there, guys.
Oh, it's right in itself.
Yeah, exactly. Speaking of the family, we can talk a little bit about Fast X. So I've always said that falls under superhero movies, as far as I'm concerned.
It does now.
Yeah.
Aren't they bringing time travel into this, or was that just a rumor?
That's just the rumor that I like to spread. That the way the franchise is going to end is that they're going to drive through, break the time barrier, and end up right where the first movie started. Full circle.
And just have like a body double for Paul Walker. Did I bring down the mood? I'm sorry.
But what I was gonna say is Jason Momoa, who was the villain of the new Fast movie, was doing a little press for Aquaman 2, you know, where he's basically saying like, go see Aquaman 2, but you know, also I might be playing somebody else. Shh. Yeah, because those Lobo rumors won't go away.
Not at all. He's not beating those rumors.
Yeah, I think
it's one of those where he just looks too perfect for the role.
Yeah, but and plus he was like, I was surprised that my movie made $1 billion.
Mm-hmm.
So I think he's playing with house money as far as with Aquaman, and he's assuming that the second movie's not going to do as well.
Right.
Narrator, it won't.
No, because it's the same with the Ezra Miller problem. There are too many people who are like, I'm not going to go see it because of Amber Heard. Regardless of anybody feels about that situation, I feel like there are a lot of people who just don't want to. They feel kind of like with the Flash problem. They're like, if I go to see this, then I'm saying that I condone the actions of this person.
Mm.
But I'm like, she already got her money.
Really? And it's not called Amber Man, right? It's called Aquaman.
And Aquaman is
right. I do believe that in the same way that with Marvel you had Ant-Man and the Wasp, I do think that there was a world in which they could have gone a different direction and made this movie more of an, you know, a two-hander where it's Aquaman and Mera together, you know, with them kind of having equal billing. But that ship had long passed, you know, and had long sailed. She's in the movie because legally they can't fire her.
Right.
even though, you know, regardless of what you think that they should fire, like legally they can't. Like there's no basis in the same way that, you know, even when they fire Johnny Depp, they paid him a substantial amount of money.
Absolutely.
To walk away. So, like, while your fandom might say, I don't want to see Amber Heard, they're from a business perspective, they're like, it's not, she's not a make or break character for this movie as right. As it's been conceived. I just think that in terms of how this movie's going to do, it's just people saw the first one. I think it's going to be similar to Shazam. People saw the first one. They weren't really clamoring for another one. They would have been good.
Yeah. Know,
if like most fans, I think, would have been good if they were like, yeah, we're just not going to do another one. We're going to quit while we're ahead. We're going to take the win, you know? And, but the fact that it made $1 billion, the studio's like, roll the dice, see if we can exactly. do it again, you know? And I think that unless the trailer's amazing, unless it just has something else going for it that's going to get people excited, I think most people are just going to say, it doesn't even really matter. It's not even, you know,
right.
It's with 50-50 on whether it's even fitting in the new universe. You know, Jason Momoa might be playing Lobo. Like, we can be the same character. be the same character, just different. So right. I just think that, and obviously this is just rumors, you know, but supposedly the same executives that were like, we are not canceling The Flash because that movie is too good, are like, I guess we have to put it out. Do you think
it'll be hurt by the fact that we already know that the DCEU is being rebooted? People are like, this isn't going to make any sense within the new timeline, so why even bother with it?
I definitely think that's going to play a role, yeah. Because I think that if they knew for a fact that it had that they had gold on their hands, that it was excellent, I think they would just say, oh no, for sure, 100%, this is part of the new universe.
Okay.
I think they're going to do kind of what they did with Shazam. Let's wait and see. Go see the movie. If you like it, we'll fit them. You know, I think it'll be written in such a way that it'll be its own thing under the water. So, you know, you could say, oh yeah, yeah, this is the same universe. Or you could, you know, in next year be like, oh no, that wasn't, that was its own thing. You know, they could gotcha. they're going to have the flexibility to disavow it. You know, but I think that if they knew for a fact that it was excellent, that it was one of the best movies they had ever made, they would just say, oh no, it's part of the new universe. Because, you know, Flash is happening. Blue Beetle, they've been sort of leaning towards saying it's part of the new universe. You know?
Right.
I think that that's telling. That they're potentially more confident in Blue Beetle than they are of Aquaman. You know, but they want to make sure that Jason Momoa stays in the fray. So he's going to get paid either way. He's good. He's good either way.
He's going to be all right.
And I think that's why what his interviews are basically saying. He's like, don't worry about me, guys. I'm good. I'm good.
He's also just one of the most laid back celebrities. Like, whether it's pictures of him walking through or just when he's on press, he's just chill as anything.
Oh yeah. And I didn't mention this, you know, when we did talk about Fast, we know who the co-writers are for the next Fast movie, Fast X Part 2. It's going to have the same director as Fast X Part 1, Louis Leterrier, but the writers are Christina Hodson, who wrote Bumblebee and The Flash. And Oren Uziel, who wrote 22 Jump Street. So
okay.
So yeah, I mean, they're right back at it. They're right back at it, you know, gonna finish out that franchise. And it's good, you know, I think this might be the first female screenwriter they've had on that franchise. So, you know, good for them.
It's about time.
Isn't it? 10 movies in, you're like the last and the furious. You know. Okay. So more screenwriting news. I'm trying to nail my transitions. More screenwriting news. We just heard as of yesterday that Blade is getting another writer. Not a new really? Writer. Not a new writer, but another writer, an additional writer. Nick Pizzolatto, who was the creator and showrunner of True Detective.
Oh, right.
Yeah, he's come aboard the Blade franchise. So, I mean, it is raising some questions because, you know, this project has gone through a number of iterations and rewrites. But the understanding is that the current script has been written by Michael Starbury, who worked on When They See Us. and Pizzolatto has been brought in to kind of, you know, tweak it. I think my guess is that Starbury doesn't have that many credits, and Pizzolatto is more of a vet, and he's just he's someone that Mahershala Ali has a pre-existing relationship with, so I'm guessing he came handpicked. We were talking a little bit in some of our other chats about whether this bodes well for the project being maybe a little bit more adult skewing than some of the other Marvel stuff. I mean, True Detective, you know, it's HBO. It's like, right. You know, it's a rougher edge. I heard some rumors, but I don't know how, you know, how valid those rumors are about it maybe being kind of like crime noir.
That's what I heard too.
And some earlier iterations of the script had it taking place in the early 21st century, in like the 1920s. As far as the locale, I guess some people had said that it might be New Orleans, but I'm hoping that if they do 1920s, they do like Harlem Renaissance. I think that would be really cool. You know, vampires in Harlem, you know?
Do you think that because, I mean, there are people like you and me and some younger generations that held the Wesley Snipes Blade movies in such high regard, do you think that that's playing into the concern around like Blade lost a director and going through all of these writers? Do you think that there's a lot riding on Blade being done right?
I think it might be the opposite. I think that this is a project that Marvel wasn't really working on. This wasn't part of their overarching, you know, phase four or five multiverse saga thing. They wanted to work with Mahershala. Mahershala said he wanted to make a Blade movie. So they're like, we're going to make a Blade movie. And gotcha. I think that the Wesley Snipes version probably has played a role, because I don't think they want to tread on the same territory. I don't think they want it to basically be, you know, a story that's constantly compared to the 90s Blade. But then I also think that they may be getting pulled in multiple directions, because that is the most iconic version of the character. So I think they may be struggling with how do we keep enough of being recognizable as Blade, like the Wesley Snipes version, but different enough and have other elements that set it apart. And that's why I like the idea of them going into the past, you know, Blade's origins in early kind of, you know, London and or Harlem or whatever, like, you know, like different communities that precede the Blade that we get in that movie. Even if where he eventually gets to is the leather jacket, sunglasses, you know, even if that's where he ends, it's fine. But if the arc of the movie takes us through different time, I think it would be cool if they had, you know, Blade across the decades, you know, being part of different Black communities at different times, you know, from the 1920s to the, you know, the Blade in the South, you know, to Blade in the 70s Black exploitation era, you know, Blade in the 90s, you know, with the high top.
Oh my God. Designs on the side.
Right. It's like, and then, because in that way, then it totally makes sense that, like, in what, like, Blade is stylish in whatever the era is. So like in the 90s, he had that 90s style, you know, like, and he just sort of evolves with the time because he's, you know, he doesn't age, you know. I think that would be kind of cool.
But it's one of those things, like, I'm kind of waiting for with bated breath, because as much as I don't like horror, but I do love the very first Blade movie.
Yeah.
I too am wondering, I'm like, are they going to take a different spin? I mean, like, we don't need another origin story. I hope they don't go that route.
Oh no, I think they're doing an origin story for sure. But I'm hoping they do an origin story where the origin's quick, you know.
Okay.
Vampire bites, but then you have him because you know, in the comics. And this is a thing that I always kind of grapple with when I discuss Blade, because the movies are so iconic, but it always grinds my gears that in the comics, his mentor is a Black man. you know, but in the movies, his mentor is a white man, you know, and, you know, that those movies are iconic. So therefore his mentor is iconic, but it bothers me. It's like, no, actually why we cut that black man out of the story. You know, right. Delroy Lindo is going to be playing his mentor in this movie. So I really want to see that relationship. You know, I want to see the relationship of how, you know, Blade is, you know, becomes the badass fighter and then take him through his paces, take him through his decades of just sort of like honing his abilities. I would imagine they'd have to cover all of that in one movie. And that might be one of the things that is causing problems with the script. Like, how do you cover 100 years? You know, how do you cover 100 years of a character in one movie? If it, you know, because there's a world in which Blade could have been a really cool TV show, you know, 12 episodes on Netflix back in the day.
Oh, absolutely.
But I don't know. I'm rooting for it. I know that there's been a lot more turmoil on this project than we normally associate with Marvel. But I also think that given the sort of mixed reviews that have happened over the last couple of years, maybe they're holding each other to higher standards now. You know, maybe they're not just saying, "Oh, we'll just fix it in post." You know, right. we'll just get Victoria Alonso to like crack the whip, put these special effects teams to work. You know,
right? Well, I'm thankful that they're finally like spacing out projects again. To give the VFX teams time to really get it, because that's one thing I know you and I have been in spaces where like that's the CGI is the one thing that gets ripped apart with each new project.
Yeah, I mean,
how is this? And they had this amount of budget, and how does the CGI look this crappy? I'm like, they've got guns to their heads.
Yeah, and it's also, I mean, a big part of it is that, you know, and my understanding is that they've been, when they weren't putting out that many projects, their willingness to sort of rewrite a movie on the fly didn't put that much of a strain on the special effects team. But when you have project lined up after project lined up after project lined up, when they think that they're done, and then someone's like, actually, you know, we watched it and we thought that maybe it would, you know, play a little better if you did this. And like, ultimately, I think that in general, that can lead to a better project overall, you know, because if you see something that doesn't work, you don't feel so invested in sticking with what doesn't work that you go through with it. However, the downside of that is that it puts the crunch on those effects teams, and then we're getting dodgy special effects. And it's not like a video game where you can be like, the first week the special effects were trash, but, you know, we put a patch in there.
Watch it now.
The effects are much better now. One day
they're going to get director's cut, like it's Blade Runner.
Exactly. They're going to try that. They're going to be like, now with finished special effects on Disney Plus.
Right?
it's Ant-Man 0.1.
Beta test.
Right, exactly. But, you know, we'll stay tuned. I mean, because that movie is supposed to come out in 2024, Blade, I believe. It'll probably get pushed back, if we're being honest. But and is that supposed to start filming in May this month?
Goodness.
So,
and then I think Thunderbolts is supposed to start filming, because you know me and my love of Sebastian Stan. I think they're supposed to start filming in Georgia in June.
Man,
for Thunderbolts. So
September 6, 2024 is supposedly Blade's release date.
Okay.
Okay.
I doubt that.
There's going to be no visual effects. That's
not at all.
They're going to be like, can we do this with all practical effects?
It's just going to be Mashallah in like mocap.
No mocap. No mocap allowed. It's going to be all camera tricks.
Right? Look over there.
It'd be like a stage play.
Oh
man. So I think that's it. It's really, we cover, oh, one little, a couple animated news. Amazon shockingly, they have more Batman. Could you imagine?
Because we're just clamoring for more Batman.
Could you imagine that there'd be more Batman? But yes, Amazon's getting a Batman feature called Merry Little Batman. So it's a Batman Christmas special. And then also Bat Family, which are going to be two animated projects that are going to be on Amazon.
Okay. So that's good. Because I would love to see, aside from Lego Batman, you really haven't gotten a lot of, except for, well, I don't know if Titans counts, but you haven't really gotten a lot of the Bat Family together in a single project outside of comics.
Yeah, I mean, Young Justice, you know, found a way to do it, but not as part of the Bat Family. It's just kind of like, you know, there's a steady flow of Batman sidekicks that just pop up on Young Justice, but you never actually see them in the context of the Bat Family. So, but I do think these, based on the animation style, these seem like they're going to be maybe for a little bit of a younger audience. So,
oh, okay.
You know, but good on, I mean, look, one of the things that people were complaining about with HBO Max is, you know, them pulling back on some of their animation projects. And their argument was that they weren't really moving the needle. So they were hoping to sort of pivot to farming out, you know, selling their projects to other platforms like they did with Batman Cape Crusader. So this kind of falls within, Amazon's got a ton of money. If Amazon wants to build out their library and pay WB, WB will gladly take the money and keep producing it. Yeah, and keep producing it. So I'm not surprised that it's more Batman content, because Batman is just the thing that nobody says no to. They're just like,
absolutely. There will always be somebody with a plate and a knife and fork, like, serve it up.
Right.
Anything on the plate.
There's also a Justice League animated movie that will be coming out. Let me see if I have a date for that. It's called Justice League War World. I don't see that. And I don't see the date for it. But the voice cast was announced. So that voice cast is Jensen Ackles as Batman. Stana Katic, who I'm not familiar with, as Wonder Woman. Darren Criss as Superman. Ike Amadi as Martian Manhunter, Troy Baker as Jonah Hex, Matt Bomer as Old Man, Roger Cross as Machiste, Brett Dalton as Batlash, Trevor Duvall as Drifter, John DiMaggio as Lobo, Robin Atkin Downs as Mongol, Frank Grillo, you know him, racist, as Agent Faraday, Rachel Kimsey as Maria Romanova, David Lodge as Sheriff, and Damian O'Hare as Demos, and Teddy Sears as Warlord. So, like I said, I don't know when the release date of this is, but we here at the Racial Draft will be following it closely, because we award points based on your characters' appearances and stuff. So that's a good enough opportunity, I guess, to transition into some of our Racial Draft business. I know this is your first appearance on the show. So your benefit, and also for the benefit of the listeners, I'm going to hit the catchphrase. What we do is change the complexion of a comic book universe one draft pick at a time. And this season, the sixth season of the Racial Draft, we've got our 10 delegations, the white in draft order, the white delegation, the Polynesian delegation, the South Asian delegation, the Swana Mena delegation, the East Southeast Asian delegation, the multiracial delegation, the Native American delegation, the Black delegation, the Latinx delegation, and the Jewish delegation. And it goes in snake draft fashion, where each round the order reverses. So 1 to 10, then 10 to 1, then 1 to 10, and so forth for our 12 rounds. And the idea is that when you draft a character, you're bringing that character into the fold for that season. You're taking that character and you're trying to, as best as possible, reimagine that character under that racial background. I try to give people the opportunity to explain what, if anything, would be changed about that character if that character was race bent. If you're protecting the character and you're saying, no, this is a pre-existing, say, black character that needs to stay black, you know, you have an opportunity to talk about why it's so important that this character, you know, remain in the fray. We do approval polls for every draft pick. If you get over 75% approval, you get bonus points. If you get over 90% approval, you get more points. Well, not bonus points, but points. they also have the opportunity to submit fan casts for those characters in their racially drafted form. And those also are subject to approval polls. In addition to the approval, we score both their comic appearances through our partners at the FCL Fantasy Comics League. They score comics based on the things that they do in the comics, the powers that they use, how much they appear, whether it's a whole very complicated scoring system. But I appreciate the hard work that they do at the Fantasy Comics League. Follow them at Fantasy Comic LG on Twitter for more about them, and you know, you can join one of their Fantasy Comics League contests. But in addition to comics, we also score their appearances in other media. So that would account for TV, movies, video games, anything kind of that features that character. I award points based on their appearances, or even trailers. Those count as well. Additionally, I score art. both original art and art that's that you might find kind of floating around on the internet that depicts your character in what could be argued their racially drafted way. And the more closely that it appears, you know, if sometimes you can say, this person looks like he could be black in this piece of art, you know. But yeah, it's like I'll score based on how closely I think that character aligns with how the character's been racially drafted. I will also score more points if it's the character that has been race bent versus the character that's staying in their natural form. Therefore, like if you're, for instance, I would never want this to happen, but if Storm were drafted by the black delegation, then you can find any number of art of Storm being black.
Right.
But if Storm were drafted by the white delegation, there really is not a lot of art floating around of a white Storm. So if you were able to find art or create art that depicts a white Storm, again, not endorsing this, not condoning this, not suggesting this, but if you were that audacious, then you would be your audacity would be rewarded with points. You know, so that's the balancing act. Are you going to be audacious for the creativity but risk no approval points? Or do you want to strike the balance of a pick that people approve of that's going to get you more points, you know, that you could still find a creative way to remix this character and, you know, both in a visual sense and in a creative writing sense. Oh, we're joined by one of our former racial draft champions, last year's runner up from the Latinx delegation, Carlos. Carlos, hey,
can you hear me?
We can. Okay. We're just kind of running down. Say hi to Taye.
Hello.
Hey, how's it going?
It's good. I'm trying to switch to gallery view because I can't see who all is in here. There it is. Okay.
Yeah. But you know, we're just going through some of the, you know, we're about to kick off the drafting for season 6. So I was just kind of walking through how things get scored for the first time listeners. I was, you know, just kind of covered the creativity. You're one of the more creative drafters. So, you know, give your perspective on as a drafter of what you shoot for when you try to get creativity points.
I try to shoot for, creativity wise, like I draw, I make art of my draft picks, and That's always
not just been... not just as your picks, as their as them as their fan cast as well.
Right, exactly. Yeah. The more accurate to the fan cast, the better. And I look for good fan casts that are like, oh man, that's money. Like Fat Joe is Kingpin.
That was and then you had a really good origin story for Latino Kingpin.
Yeah, the backstories, if you can make them work. A lot of times though, it's just like nothing really changes. He's just Mexican now or whatever. You know, like it's not.
Yeah,
which is kind of the thesis of the whole project.
Right? Sure. Yeah,
these characters and don't have to be.
They don't have to change that radically. Yes. I mean, you know, the thing that I always kind of come down to is like, can it be additive without being subtractive? You know, can you bring something new to the character without taking any essential qualities away from the character? And in my mind, the best picks are the ones that can do that.
Yeah. I mean, sometimes, you know, sometimes it's the fourth round and Thor is still there, then I'm going to have to figure out how Thor is Dominican. I don't know. You know, like if I've given you every other team enough chances to take a character, it's like, all right, then I guess Guatemalan T'Challa is just going to have to be what it is because I gave you enough chances. But for the most part, I try to
you gave us Dominican Sam Wilson.
Yes, I did. with a better fan cast than the MC, let me just be real. Laz Alonso, come on.
All right. That's fair. I mean, I do like Laz Alonso. And you had Laz Alonso as Blade once, didn't you?
We might have. Yeah, I think it was my first season actually that me and Martin had Blade.
Yes. So, you know, we try to have fun with the fan cast, and I hope that continues. And also with the drafts. I mean, I guess we can talk about it now. The element that we introduced last season of the dynasty draft of characters that you draft that you get to keep. This will be fun, Taye.
Okay.
You're Black. Yes. So I will run down the dynasty picks from the Black delegation, the ones that will be part of that will be carried forward into season six. Just give me a thumbs up, thumbs down. Not I mean verbally, verbal thumbs up, thumbs down as I run down these picks.
Okay.
Wait for it. All right. John Stewart.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Okay. Sync from the X-Men.
Eh.
Okay. Ironheart.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Always. Riri is my everything.
Vixen.
That's so weird. I could go either way with her. Okay. But yeah.
All right. John Henry Iron Steel.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
That makes Cage. Sense.
Come on now. It's Luke Cage.
I'm just making sure. Misty Knight.
Yes. She's one of my dream cosplays.
Okay. Oh yeah, you also we can cosplay gets points too.
Okay.
Natasha Iron Steel, the younger Steel.
Okay.
Bishop.
Yeah.
The X-Men.
Mm-hmm.
Wakanda, the entire country, because you can draft places.
Oh,
as
word?
Long as you can, yeah, as long as they're fictional. As long as they're fictional, you can draft them.
Gotcha. Okay.
So yeah, Wakanda, I mean, yeah. Simon Williams, Wonder Man, who's going to be played by Yaya in the
MCU. That's right. Why did that completely slip my mind that that's happening? Okay. Yeah.
And Carter Hall Hawkman, who you just saw in Black Adam.
Black Adam. One of the few bright spots in that movie, honestly, but yeah.
All right, so I feel like that was more, you know, almost unanimous, but not quite, you know, a couple S in there.
Yeah.
but yeah, so these characters will remain with the Black delegation unless they're traded or unless they the way it works is that we have each season we have a single season draft, which we're about to start, and then and all the characters get drafted in the single season draft, get thrown back into the pool for the next season, and then we have the dynasty draft, which you get to keep. But if you draft that character, you have you're the only delegation that has the right to draft that character in a subsequent season. So let's say those characters of the ones that you named, let's say that you wanted to draft Bishop in your season draft in order to get access to all of the points that you would get, because you get scored differently whether you're in the season draft or whether you're in the dynasty draft. So you might say, Bishop is kind of hot right now. He's in a bunch of projects. There's a rumor that he might get a movie or whatever. I think I'm going to draft him, you know, and try to score points with him. You can do that, but that means he goes back into the pool for next season to be redrafted, to be drafted by someone else.
Gotcha. Yeah.
So you can hold on to these characters and get, you know, a few of the categories, or you can draft them to get all the categories. So that's the new strategy element. Also, I should mention, trades are possible. And when you make a trade, your trade can be approved of by the audience. So when you do a trade, it's they trade the character that you're getting. Mm-hmm. They trade the character the other person's getting. I mean, that gets rated, sorry. And then also the trade just as an acquisition. So you have the possibility of earning extra points if you make a trade that people like the fact that you're gaining the character and people like the trade overall. You can get a bunch of points. If it turns out that you made a pick in a previous season in Dynasty or in the current season that's not going over well, you might say, I might want to make this trade and get a second shot at those approval points. So
okay.
So like if the Latinx delegation has like Shang-Chi and the East Asian delegation has like America Chavez and we trade, that might actually get a good approval from the poll because be like, yes, that seems more right than
exactly, you know,
than Honduran Shang-Chi and could be an American Chavez.
Right. I mean, I'm looking at your roster right now. There's not too many characters that could be on the trading block, right, for the Latinx delegation. For your benefit, Tay, I'll let you know. I'll list off the Latinx dynasty characters: Ava Ayala, White Tiger; Miguel O'Hara, Spider-Man 2099; Sam Alexander, Nova; Bane; Harvey Dent, Two-Face, Dos-Face, sorry; Yara Flor, Wonder Girl; James Gordon. Who was your fan cast for James Gordon?
Who was my fan cast for James Gordon this time? Jimmy Smits.
As James Gordon. Renee Montoya, Joaquin Torres, Anya Corazon, Parker Robbins the Hood, who's being played by, what's the actor's name?
Anthony Ramos,
yes. And Victor Alvarez, Power Man, Dominican Power Man.
I think that's canon, right? I'm pretty sure he's Dominican in the comics.
Right, exactly. So yeah, I mean, of those characters, you know, we might have to sit this one out on the trade blocks, but
I mean, there's Harvey Dent out there, Jim Gordon.
Yeah, but he's one more. No, but here's the thing, Tay, Oscar Isaac was his fan cast for Harvey Dent.
Ooh,
yeah. It's so good.
That's real good.
That one really works. It works really well. Yeah.
Other than
Jimmy Smits is Jim Gordon too, honestly.
No. I mean, it's good.
Definitely.
You know,
The Black delegation needs to make some artwork of Riri and Natasha Irons doing the Spider-Man meme.
Wait a second. We need to get Sally on. We need to get Sally on to do that one.
If Natasha Irons. If there is an Amalgam Comics, those would be the two those characters would be back together.
Yeah, for sure. I like that. I like the Spider-Man thing. Yeah, the pointing with the armor too. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. And oh, the other character that could potentially be traded if Tori is interested is Yara Flor, because she is an indigenous Brazilian character. So she is just as much a Native American claim as she is Latinx.
Yeah, but you know, Yara's not having her hot girl moment anymore.
Which is why she stays in the, yeah, she'll stay in the cupboard until it's time to cook.
You know, I mean, multiracial delegation, they're always a wild card, you know.
They're a cheat code.
They're a cheat code. Miguel O'Hara's are sitting right there for the multiracial delegation.
Yeah,
they're the universal donor is what we
need. Oh my goodness.
Oh man. So you have any more questions? Have any questions for both for your benefit and the benefit of the listeners? Things that I might not have covered.
I'm still a little confused. So I just would say I want to see this character as a different race and different backstory, or I have a fan cast for this person.
So we have the draft order.
Where do I start?
Yeah. So again, we have the draft order starting tomorrow, and you know, listeners, by the time you hear this, it'll be today. Follow us on the various socials: Racial Draft Pod on Twitter, Racial Draft on Facebook, and Racial.Draft on Instagram to follow along. So you'll see. When your delegation is up in the draft, you'll submit to me what your pick is. I'll make the announcement. And then we're off to the races. You know, the picks will be there'll be a poll on Twitter while Twitter still allows polls. be a poll on Twitter. It'll have a week to campaign. You know, do whatever it takes to get people to approve of your polls. You know, you have as much time as you want as far as throughout the season to submit a fan cast. So if you don't have one immediately, you can wait. But once that poll goes in, then, you know, 7 days on the poll, you know, you can campaign, and, you know, it's all in that respect. Oh, the other thing that I should have mentioned is that this is a new scoring wrinkle that I introduced. Likes will be taken into account. So if you get over 100 likes on one of your, on either your picks or your content, I'll also award some extra points if you get likes. So, you know, there's the incentive out there to, once you make the pick, kind of tout the pick, you know?
Gotcha.
So, and yeah, backstory, you know, if you have a, like an explanation, you know, if you want to give your own 10, 30 second clip or whatever, explaining the pick, or explaining what you would change about just the little tweaks that you would have about the character, we could submit that as well. But the idea is that when you get it's one round a week, right?
Okay.
I should have mentioned that. So we're one round a week. So that means every week you have one pick to focus on. And then, you know, as they're being picked, rapidly totaling up the scores. I'm giving people periodic updates as to where we are in the scoring.
Okay.
So that's a lot of work on my part, you know, keeping up with the scoring, you know, because we score new. Oh, I should have mentioned that as well. We also score news. So anytime there's news about the character, if there's news about a project that is focused on your character will get some points. If there's news about that specific character, the character will get points. You know, so
gotcha.
That's one thing to consider strategically in terms of trying to figure out who to draft first. You know, who are the most high profile characters, the characters that get the most exposure and get, you know, and as we go down the list, because it's 12 rounds, as we, you know, get down into the later rounds, that's when you can, you know, take bigger swings and bolder swings, you know, of a character that may not be as heavily featured as the highest of the high profile characters.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
I might need some time to get my thoughts together. My first pick.
Well, look, Randy's around. Randy's an experienced. Randy's been with us for a little bit, so definitely put your head together with Randy, and talk to him. You know about it. You know, because he's always got a ton of ideas. You know,
I think the Black delegation drafts. I mean, tentatively, assuming there are no like delays, Thursday afternoon, right? Would be
because they have with the eighth pick, it would be Thursday evening, afternoon.
Thursday p.m. and then every other week would be Tuesday a.m.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
Yeah.
Okay. Good.
Just to have like a mindset of like how long you got to make a pick. So
exactly. Yeah. But yeah, I mean, I've always meant for it to be kind of communal. That's why it's a delegation. So, you know, always trying to bring in new people, new voices, and you know, we a lot of Black people. There's people who can easily have ideas about characters to draft, and you know, and perspectives and things to contribute, as far as from a creative standpoint or from a, you know, you know, even if you want to like make memes, you know, like memes count as creativity. So, you know, I've been telling Randy for years that he needs to better harness the power of Black Twitter, because he's leaving points on the table, not bringing some of these characters to Black Twitter. So,
yeah, I'm probably gonna hit him up after we're done here, like, help.
But either way, I mean, you know, you're gonna be joining us hopefully every week. So I'm gonna love seeing your opinions of these characters as they're drafted. You know, just kind of, you know, because it's old hat for me. I'm used to some of the boldest, most audacious of picks. I mean, what did we do? We had White Luke Cage, right? From White Luke Cage from Boston.
Yeah, wasn't there a season where was it the White delegation had Shang-Chi and they traded, and it was like, why didn't you trade for this other character who clearly would fit your delegation? Oh, I can't remember what it is now, but it was like, it was two delegations trading with each other. It's like, these are not the characters you should be trading. This doesn't make any sense. Like, you, like Native American Shang-Chi, maybe. Oh, I can't remember.
Native American Shang-Chi killed me. I was like, what are you doing? Yeah. There's nothing Native American about Shang-Chi at all.
Yeah, there are a few characters like I won't touch. Like, I can't make a Latinx Miss Marvel work. I can't do it. It's just like, I have stretched, you know, I have stretched backstories as far as I can. I cannot make.
Yeah, especially since she doesn't stretch anymore.
Exactly. So, yeah. But yeah, Shang-Chi's another one. It's like, nope, that one is, pretty important.
And I should have mentioned, this is really important. I the reason that I forgot it is because last season, no one took advantage of it. We have a challenge system. If a character gets drafted and you believe that the character is inherently broken, essentially, by that character being re-spent in that fashion, will have the opportunity to make the case and to confiscate that character for your delegation. But the risk you run is if your challenge is unsuccessful, you forfeit your draft pick, your next draft pick to that delegation. So it's a little bit of a risk, but if you really feel like a pick is egregious, then you can mount a challenge and you leave it up to the people to decide. You know, you come on the show, you present your case, or you have me present your case on your behalf. And they have the opportunity to, you know, have a rebuttal case, and then we leave it up to the people to decide.
Okay.
So keep that in mind. You know, if you go a little too crazy,
it happens. You know,
it does happen. I had to institute some things to rein it in a little bit, but But you know,
okay.
People still try. I mean, look, like I've said before, the multiracial delegation, the delegation of daywalkers, all the strengths and none of the weaknesses. So, I don't think we have any other news to cover. I already said what the draft order is. I'll remind people again, the white delegation starting us off, followed by the Polynesian, South Asian, Swanamena, East Southeast Asian, multiracial, Native American, Black, Latinx, and then our champion Jewish delegation in the 10th pick. We kick off very soon. So come back. Like I said, same race time, same race channel. Find out what picks were picked in the first round of the racial draft. Tay, let the people know where they can find you.
You can find me on Instagram, on YouTube, and on TikTok, and on that big blue bird app, Twitter, all at Taylani Stark.
Carlos, where can they find you?
I'm at Carlos Freitas Jr. on Twitter, and that's really the only one I check. So don't look for me in the other ones. I'm boring on everything else.
Don't you write for a certain place?
I write for a website called agentsoffandom.com. It has been a minute since I have written because my job is just crunching, just like squeezing me out. So, but yeah, you can find some of my writings at agentsoffandom.com. And there's a ton of good stuff going up there all the time. And it's not from me. So
okay, check them out. You know, look at him promoting.
Look at you promoting for me. It's what really happened there.
Yeah, you can find my somewhat occasional writings at Murphy's Multiverse, where right now I have a spoiler-free review of Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3 that you could read. Hope by next week, hopefully you've seen it, so you can find out whether your thoughts align with mine. You can also find me on Twitter at MTFIII. You can find the Racial Draft, like I said before, at Racial Draft Pod on Twitter, racial.draft on Instagram, and Racial Draft on Facebook. Join us, follow us. We will probably get that, get our channels popping with some exclusive content, some not behind the scenes, but like beside the scenes content. So, you know, it's benefit to follow us on all different platforms. But that's about it. You know, we're going to get you going. If you were an NFL fan, it's still draft season because it's racial draft season. So yeah. until next time, all things are possible.